Dear students, today we are discussing about the working principle of induction stove. In this lecture, we will look at why we have to use this type of vessels in the induction stove, why we can't use glass beakers, If I keep hand in the induction stove when it is on, so what is going to be happen? So, we will discuss more complete practical examples in today's class. Before going to the induction topic, let's recap our concepts once. One related to the Ampere's law, second one magnetic flux, Faraday's law and Lenz's law. So, in the case of Ampere law, I am taking the conducting wire, I am passing the current in one direction. So, when the current flows in up direction, so there is a magnetic field associated. The direction of magnetic field is given by the curled fingers in this direction. So, with respect to this figure, the magnetic field into the board, the magnetic field around the current carrying loop. So, this is said to be the Ampere's law. Now, let us look at the transformer. In the transformer, I have taken the two coils. N1 is the number of turns in the primary coil, N2 is the number of turns in the secondary coil. I am connecting to the alternating current source. Whenever there is a current, alternating current flowing through a coil, there is a association of magnetic field. So, this magnetic field is linked with respect to this particular number of turns of the coil. Once there is a change of magnetic flux in this particular coil, it produces an induced EMF. So, that causes an induced current. So, this is the working principle of a transformer. Suppose I want to increase the secondary voltage or decrease the voltage, that depends upon the number of turns associated in this particular coil. So, the electromagnetic induction principles, they have wide number of applications in the day-to-day life example, like motors, transformers, generators and inductors, the works on the principle of induction stove. So, let us look at this example. So, here I am taking a primary coil, there is n number of turns. This is the secondary coil which is connected to the LED light. When I am switching on this, I am passing the current through the primary coil, this is a secondary coil. When I am keeping close together, it generates the light, So, there is a wireless transfer of energy here, I am passing the current through the primary coil, it produces a magnetic field, that is magnetic field induced in this particular secondary coil, I am connecting to the LED light. So, due to that there is a transfer of electrical energy. So, this type of applications we are using now in a especially about mobile charging, especially new end cars or Apple phone, we can charge directly by using this method. Wireless energy transfer. This is one of the example. So, let me go for other example. So, this is said to be the Tesla coil. There is a primary coil followed by the secondary coil. The secondary coil having more number of turns here. So, when the current is passing through the coil, when the current is passing through the primary coil, it links with the secondary coil. More amount of the electrical energy is generated here. So, there is a change of magnetic field of the primary coil is connected to the secondary coil. So, there is a lot of induced energy associated around this. So, I can say that a large amount of voltage is spread around this particular region. That energy is too high. If I bring any LED, the CFL lamp near to this place, so that it starts glowing. So, this is the Tesla coil experiment. There is a transfer of energy near to this. Like this, we can transfer the energy from one end to other end during this phenomena. When a distance is moving away from here, the energy, the fields associated with respect to this, it keeps on decreases. It is glowing much brighter when it come to the near place. Like this, we can transfer the energy from one end to the other end without any connecting sources. This is a wireless energy transfer. Like this, we can have number of applications in the day-to-day life. So let me go for other example. Let me go for other concept here. Here I am taking a coil which is connected to the galvanometer. The galvanometer which senses the deflection. Here I am considering about the induced current. I have taken the strong magnet. That magnet I am moving into the coil with a greater velocity. Once the magnetic field associated with respect to the coil, I am calling as a magnetic flux. The flux within the coil disturbs within a faster manner, that causes an induced EMF. Let me say it causes an induced EMF, produces induced current. So that galvanometer shows a deflection in one direction, let me say in the right side. If I change the magnet, that means south to north I kept, I changed to north to south. The same process I am repeating here. Once again, this magnetic flux disturbs, that change in magnetic flux produces the current. So that current directs to the galvanometer and moves in a opposite direction. That means how fast the flux is changing with respect to the coil, that plays to produce the induced current. Let me go for other observation. I kept the magnet into the coil in a stationary mode. At that point, I am not observing any deflection. Why? Because the flux associated with respect to the magnet, it remains constant. The flux lines entering at this particular corner and flux leaves this particular corner, the equal number of flux lines, there is no change of that. So due to that, you may get the zero deflection. So with respect to this experiment, we conclude that whenever there is a change of magnetic flux with respect to the coil, there is an induced EMF is associated. That induced EMF is given by the Faraday law. So the electromotive force around any closed circuit is equal to the negative rate of change of flux linked with this particular circuit. I repeat, the induced EMF is equal to negative rate of change of magnetic flux linked with the circuit. The direction of induced EMF is given by the Lenz law. The Lenz law says that it always opposes the growth of the current. So let me go with one example I want to demonstrate here. The Lenz law is based on conservation of energy. Here I have taken a metal cylindrical ball here. Let me observe the fact now. When I left this cylindrical metal ball, a spherical metal ball in this tube, it takes faster, it moves so faster because of the gravitational pull. Now, in the same case, if I deal with the chalk piece also, let me go with the chalk piece also, it comes so faster. Now, what happens if I take in the magnet? Let me tell you, I have taken the strong magnets, arranged in a stack of magnets. What happens when I introduce a magnet into the copper tube? The speed is in the same like metal spherical ball, or speed is reduces. Let me analyze now. There is a lot of concept is involved in this. Let me try once. I have taken a magnet, copper tube. The same process I am doing now. It takes longer time period. I repeat. So what is happening here? We have to understand what the physics involved in that. So this magnet produces a magnetic field. That magnetic field is passed, that magnetic field is connected to the copper tube. There is a change of magnetic flux that produces induced current in the copper tube. These induced currents are spreading only on the surface of the copper tube. That induced current produces a magnetic field. That magnetic field counterbalancing this particular magnetic field. So, there is a resistance is associated. I repeat, there is a change of magnetic flux due to this particular magnet, I am calling as a primary magnetic field. This primary magnetic field produces the induced current in the copper tube. That induced current spreading only on the surface, that currents I am calling as a eddy currents. That eddy current produces the magnetic field, I am calling as a secondary magnetic field. That magnetic field is producing the resistance of this, so that there is a change. So, this magnetic field produced within the copper tube is resisted in the movement of the magnet. So, this is based on the Lenz law. So, this Lenz law is based on conservation of energy. The Lenz law is based on conservation of energy. Let's see a practical demonstration of induction. So, this is a coil which is connected to the galvanometer. When the magnet is introduced, it shows a deflection. So, the induced electromotive force any closed circuit is equal to the negative rate of change of magnetic flux through the circuit. The direction of induced EMF or electromotive force is given by the Lenz law. The Lenz law is analogous to the Newton's third law of motion, nothing but action and reaction. So, the induced electromotive force always gives rise to a current whose magnetic field opposes the original change of flux. I repeat, the induced electromotive force always gives rise to a current. The current produces a magnetic field which opposes the original change of magnetic flux. In the case of electromagnetic induction, I told earlier, this electromagnetic induction has a wide applications in the present day market. This can be used in the transformers, motors, generators and inductor coils. This concept of electromagnetic induction is also used in the metal detectors. Let me observe the concept here. So, I have taken the current carrying wire, I am passing the alternating current. Whenever there is a change of current, there is a magnetic field. So, the magnetic field is going to be maximum or minimum depends upon the alternating current field. Now, I am bringing one more current carrying conductor within the premises of the magnetic field. So, what happens here? This change of flux produces the current, that current is called as induced current. This induced current is confined only on the surface, that currents I am calling as eddy currents. The eddy current meaning nothing but it circulates within the same, that means at that point it circulates. This eddy currents are also a form of induced currents. So, let me analyze here, I have taken a coil, I am passing the alternating current through this particular coil. So, this magnetic field produces the currents in a conducting plate. So, this is nothing but the eddy currents. The concept of eddy is nothing but it circulates at the same point. This magnetic field produces the eddy currents in the conducting coil on the surface. So, how the eddy currents are concentrated in the material, that plays an important role in the heating concept. Let me see the animation here. So, the primary coil, I am passing the current, it produces the magnetic field. The blue line shows the magnetic field, this is the induced current. So, this induced current produces the magnetic field. So, the blue lines shows the magnetic field produced by this coil, this produces the eddy currents. Now, with respect to this eddy currents, it also produces the magnetic field in the opposite direction. So, here if you take a conducting plate which is a ferromagnetic material, the larger eddy currents are associated. If you take the glass material, so there is no production of eddy currents because a glass is an insulator. So, this is the concept of electromagnetic induction. Now, this eddy currents produces the magnetic field. This magnetic field is counterbalancing the primary magnetic field. So, due to this particular magnetic field, there is a resistance is offered by the material due to the resistance offered by the material, there is a Joule heating effect. So, H is equal to I square RT. So, due to this phenomena, the induction stove gets heated up. So, let me analyze in a one particular chart. So, this is the primary coil which is there in the induction stove. We are connecting to the alternating current source, it produces a magnetic field. I am taking the container. This container is made with the cast iron or stainless steel. So, why I am considering this particular materials? Because the skin depth associated, the skin depth of the magnetic field in the material is less. They confined only on the surface, so that we are getting the larger eddy currents. So, once there is a change of magnetic field, it produces a current on the stainless steel or cast iron, which this eddy currents are produced in the material. So, this eddy currents produce a magnetic field. This magnetic field opposing the field caused by the primary coil, so it offers a resistance. Once there is a resistance, there is a Joule heating effect, H is equal to I square RT. Otherwise, we can see that whenever there is a magnetic flux changes within the material, that causes a induced current, I am calling as a eddy currents. That eddy currents confined only in the surface of the material. So, there is a resistance offered by the material, so that current and the resistance produces the heating effect. This is the working principle of an induction stove. Here one point we have to understand, what type of material we are keeping on the induction stove and how the heat is transferred to the material. In general, nowadays on the induction stove, if you observe the vessels, the downside is coated with the cast iron or aluminium. Aluminium and copper cannot be used as in the induction stove. Even though they have the good thermal conducting property, but there is a less resistance is offered due to the skin depth. Due to that, the heating effect will be minimum. To avoid that, we are taking the cast iron or stainless steel, where the thickness is greater than the skin depth of the magnetic field. So, more resistance is offered, then the heating effect will be maximum. The eddy currents produces the heat, that heat should be circulated throughout the vessel. That is the reason the bottom of the cooking vessel they are attaching this aluminium or copper. Yeah, let us see the cross section of the induction stove. This induction stove consists of a primary coil with a copper wire, is a primary coil. This connected to the alternating current source, and this is the fan, this is the fan, this is the thermistor, and this is the PCB board. When the alternating current passing through the coil, it produces the change of magnetic field. That magnetic field produces here. This surface is the ceramic glass, so that is a bad conductor of heat. This is the magnetic field produces here, produced on the top. If you keep any vessel, it produces the induced current on the vessel. This is the vessel. When you place it in the pan, this magnetic field produces the currents in the material. Due to that, the heat is produced. So, when you are passing the current through this coil, it may get heated up. That heat can be prevented by keeping a fan. The fan is kept for that purpose. So, the temperature on the vessel can be detected by the thermistor. This is a thermistor, so which controls the temperature measurement, so that we can set the temperature, so that is going to be operated at that particular temperature. So, this is about the cross sectional view of the induction stove. Now, let we operate the induction stove and we can check once. Now operating the induction stove, I have taken the vessel now, I kept it here and pour in the water. Now, let me see the noise first. Now, I am operating. The induction, the heat produces in a faster manner here. So I'm pouring the water. The rapid transfer of heat here. It's a rapid transfer of heat here. So within a shorter time period compared to the conventional heating, like keeping on the stove, it takes less than time period. Okay, now I'm dropping down. I'm dropping down. Let me try with the glass beaker, it get heated up or not. I said the glass is an insulator which does not produces any induced current, so nothing is going to be happen. So nothing. So we cannot use the glassware on an induction stove which does not get heated up. Let me give some time, nothing. Even though I put water droplet on this, nothing going to be happen. This is a ceramic, glass ceramic, which is a heat insulator. So let me try. I'm keeping hand on induction stove. I'm keeping hand on induction stove. Nothing is going to be happen. Why? Because I'm not a conducting material, so that there is no induced current. So nothing is going to be happen to me. Please don't try it home. This is what I'm trying to show you. So nothing is going to be happen to me. If I keep near to this, definitely there's a current produced and there's a conducting plate. So we can now, especially when you're operating the induction stove, you may get some electromagnetic induction acoustic noise. You're seeing somewhat humming sound. Why? Because in the induction stove, this induction stove vessel is made with a different type of materials. The induction stove materials are made with a different type of materials. The layer by layer they coated on this. If the binding is not proper, so you may get some humming noise. That's called acoustic noise. So in this particular induction vessel plates, the bottom is coated with the aluminium. Why? Because aluminium is a good conductor of heat. This aluminium copper cannot be used in induction stove, but they are used here because of is a thicker, the currents are produced, the current produces the heat. That heat should be circulated throughout the uniform. So that is the reason that they are using aluminium or copper in this particular base. So this is about the induction stove. I hope you all understood. I repeat once again. The induction stove works on the principle of electromagnetic induction. So this induction stove can be used anywhere. Thank you.